And turn with me to the book of Philippians. The book of Philippians. And it's the second chapter. Our emphasis will be taken today. Philippians, the second chapter. And let us begin reading at verse 5. Philippians, the second chapter. And let's read verse 5. Beginning at verse 5. Let's all read it together if we have the King James Version. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of man. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, and things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Father, unctionize me for this moment in time. Speak to me and through me. In the blessed name of Jesus, I ask. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. I have for a subject the attitude of Christ.
Amen.
Mm.
The attitude of Christ.
Amen.
You will find this subject all through these verses, and you'll find that there are four characteristics that Paul points out here that makes up the attitude of Christ. When he says in verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, he's simply talking about having the attitude of Christ manifested or displayed or exhibited in and through our lives.
Amen.
It's an attitude he's talking about. And so we want to look at the four components that he outlines here in our text, in our lesson. And the first attitude is humility.
Amen.
Could you say humility?
Humility.
Humility is the first attitude that makes up, if we're going to have the mind or the attitude of Christ and display it down here in this world. I was looking for a definition for humility. And if I will give you a book definition from Webster's, you might not even remember. So I decided to look at verse 3. You can see what humility looks like in verse 3. Do you see it there? He says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. Now, vainglory is when two believers are in rivalry with each other. They're battling with each other. They're believers, but they're battling, striving with each other. And basically, they do it because they're selfish. Selfish. Let nothing be done. Vainglory. Vainglory points of rivalry. It can be in church and tears up churches. Rivalry. Let nothing be done through vainglory. And by the way, when you read this, you look over there in Philippians, the fourth chapter, I believe it's verse 2. And there were two women in this church. Now, Paul is in prison, but he heard about it. And the English name of one was Fragrance. That's a beautiful name.
Yes.
And the English name of the other was Fortune. Fragrance and Fortune had locked horns. Paul does not tell us what caused these two women to lock horns in the church.
Amen.
And what was happening then in this new church, it was destroying the unity of the church.
Amen.
The unity of the church. Unity comes from within. It's a grace within. Uniformity is something from without. It's rules and laws you have in your house to keep the order. And even the dog has to obey the rules and the order.
Yeah.
And he knows the rules and the regulations. But unity is a grace in the heart. It means you have to get your heart right with Christ.
Amen.
So when there's rivalry, especially among us, it's something in our heart. Because the heart of every problem is a heart, problem of the heart.
Amen.
You got to get our hearts right.
Yes.
So unity then, he says here, let each, verse 3, watch it. Let each esteem other better than themselves.
Amen.
Put the other person before yourself.
Amen.
Put that other person before yourself.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't put that other person before yourself, you're a lot more. Not only that, you'll never ever have no joy upon this earth. You may be saved.
Yes.
But when you put yourself on the throne of your life, and that other person puts himself or herself on the throne of life, you all will love more.
Yes.
You'll never, never have joy. You can only have joy, Christian joy, J-O-Y. Or you can be happy if some good things happen to you. But if you want joy, you have to commit your life totally to Christ.
Amen.
And submit yourself to other people. If you don't submit yourself to other people, you will never find joy in this life.
Amen.
Not in this. You can be saved. So they have destroyed the unity. Unity then speaks of putting others first here, verse 3. Let me take my time. I want to teach it. Let each esteem other better than themselves mean consider that other person more important than yourself.
Amen.
That is the thrust of the message. You see, when Christ was up yonder in heaven, the Bible teaches here, we will look at it, he was God.
Amen.
He was God, but
fully God.
He didn't need anything. But he put my need and your need before himself.
Yes.
Instead of going back. And you know, I give thanks to God.
Amen.
I'm so glad that he was a humble person.
Yes.
Christ was a humble person. He had a submissive mouth. He put the needs of others before himself.
Yeah.
And that's the thrust. If you're going to be Christ-like, first you got to have a humble mind.
Amen.
A submissive mind.
Yeah.
You can find some happiness if some good things happen to you. But it ain't going to last long.
Well.
Joy is something you can have in the midst of tough folks, even on a job.
Amen.
Amen.
You can have joy. You can have peace that passes all understanding. I'm preaching to myself.
Amen.
Because God once put me in a church, and I won't tell you what city it was, not so much to help the folks, but to help me. Them folks humbled me. And the only way I made it was through prayer and fasting and humbled myself. And they never could overthrow me. Amen? So the first characteristic that you have to have is a humble mind. And this is so important. I want to stress it. A humble mind. Let me, I ain't gonna ask you to hold up your hand. How many of you then have a submissive mind? I'll look around. I'll look around. Well, I ain't gonna put up my hand then. A submissive mind. A humble mind. Now, a humble mind doesn't mean that you're going to be somebody's religious doormat.
Amen.
No, that ain't what he's talking about.
Say that.
It is my belief, and I know I'm right. I'm not, as I think it was Winston Churchill once said, I'm not always right, but I'm rarely wrong in some things.
Amen.
To be a leader and a true servant, you have to have two qualities inside of you. You got to be tough-minded.
Amen.
And tender-hearted.
Amen.
Tough-minded and tender-hearted.
Amen.
The French call it antithesis strongly marked. These are two opposites you have to have in your personality. You have to be able to say no to some people.
Amen.
I ain't going to do it.
Amen.
No. And you have to know when to say yes.
Yes.
These are antitheses. It has to be in your personality. And if you don't know how to say no to some people, you become their doormat.
Amen.
And that's not what he's talking about.
Amen.
Humility. Do I have to stay any longer on that?
Keep going.
Okay.
Amen.
I think I've made my point.
Do your thing.
Humility. So it's the first quality that you have to have if you're going to have a Christ-like attitude. Look then at the second quality. And it's found here, let me just jump here in verse 6. Verse 6, speaking of Jesus, who being in the form of God, he was God up yonder. In his pre-incarnate glory, if you read John 17 and verse 5, you'll find that Jesus was God up yonder. I don't know what the Muslims say. He possessed form of God, don't mean the size of God. God's a spirit.
Amen.
John 4 and 24. God is a spirit. God, Jesus said, a spirit, they put it in the Bible, but it's God is spirit. God feels all immensity, all eternity. In fact, the heavens of heavens cannot contain God.
Amen.
God is something of God.
Amen.
And God, Jesus, ruled the universe. If you read John 17 and 17 and verse 5, in his pre-incarnate glory, he ruled the universe along with the Father and the Holy Ghost. They ruled. They didn't need us. In his pre-incarnate glory, form of God. But notice what it said about him, because he had a humble mind. Who being in the form of God, very God of very God, as the old Puritans used to say, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. He did not hold on to his prerogatives.
Amen.
All his prerogatives as God.
Yes.
All the bliss and the glory. He didn't hold on to that. He did something. Because he had a humble mind, he did something. And the Bible tells us exactly what he did here in verse 7. But made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant.
Amen.
Now watch this. Form of God. Form of a servant. And that's very important, because Jesus was the outward expression of the inward nature of God. That's what form of God means. So when he came down here and put on flesh, he was the same way. He took on the form. He was a genuine, bona fide servant when he came down here. He came down in the form of a servant. That's why the Jews missed him. They were looking for some kind of Messiah that would overthrow Rome. You know what I mean? They were all messed up. And here come humble Jesus along. They said, no way. No way. But he was a form. He had the nature. He was a bona fide servant when he arrived down here upon this earth.
Amen.
Serving other folks. I like that. Form of God. Form of a servant. So being the form of a servant, the reason why he put himself, came in the form of a servant, so he could